As might have been expected during a wild and exciting WAC football season, several individuals made their marks in league history. At Brigham Young, quarterback Robbie Bosco finished his career second in WAC all-time passing yardage and third in total offense, despite the fact he was a starter for only 2 years. Teammate Mark Bellini was one of two players to have more than 1,000 yards in reception. At number 94, Trevor Mellini fell just short of the NCAA record for catches by a tight end. Versatile Vi Sukahima set new conference standards for career punt returns and return yardage, while Glenn Kozlowski finished his career among the WAC's elite pass catchers despite missing more than half the season with an injury. Despite the fireworks at BYU, the WAC's Offensive Player of the Year honors went to the Air Force quarterback Bart Weiss. He directed the explosive Falcon wishbone and became only the third player in NCAA history to both rush and pass for more than 1,000 yards in a season. In addition, he accounted for 20 touchdowns either by passing or running. When opponents paid too much attention to the ground game, Weiss usually hooked up with Ken Carpenter. The two combined to average more than 20 yards per completion, the best such average in the conference. Defensively, junior Tom Rotello led the WAC with 8 interceptions. He played on a team which had 28 thefts, the second highest total in the country. Senior Scott Thomas chipped in with 6 interceptions, but it was his return ability that often broke games open. Thomas became only the 5th player in NCAA history to return a kickoff, a punt, and an interception for a touchdown in the same season. The king of all big play men, however, was Utah's Earl Tucker. The Ute senior not only equaled Thomas's mark for return touchdowns, he had at least 2 in each category. In addition, Tucker led the nation in both kickoff and punt return average. Teammate Larry Egger was the WAC's Rookie of the Year, while Eddie Lewis was one of 5 WAC running backs to surpass the 1,000-yard mark in 1985. San Diego State also featured big play personnel. Quarterback Todd Santos set a WAC sophomore total offense record, while running back Chris Hardy included 2 92-yard runs among his 1,150 yards for the season. Number 88, Webster Slaughter, was the league's best all-purpose performer. He created havoc with his pass receiving. Slaughter led the WAC with 82 catches for more than 1,000 yards. He was also one of the top kick return men in the conference. The 1985 rushing title went to Colorado State's Steve Bartello. The durable junior set a school record with 1,368 yards, and his 338 carries established a WAC single season record. Included was a league high 8 games of 100 or more yards rushing, and he was an excellent receiver. Barring injury, Bartello will become the WAC's all-time leading rusher in 1986. At New Mexico, quarterback Billy Rucker set a single-season school record and ranked 10th nationally with nearly 2,900 yards total offense, while running back Willie Terrell finished his career among the WAC's all-time leaders. Hawaii's Walter Murray had a superb senior season as he established a new WAC record for career receiving yards and fell just short of 1,000 yards for the season. Teammate Nu Fa'aola also was effective, as he was one of just 2 backs in the conference to average more than 100 yards per game rushing. UTEP unveiled freshman running back John Harvey, perhaps the best first-year player in the conference when he was healthy. Despite missing 3 games, Harvey still rushed for nearly 800 yards. At Wyoming, Alan Griffin surpassed the 100 mark in career receptions, and there were many other highlights. Place kickers Chris O'Brien at San Diego State and Andre Guardi at Utah set conference standards for consecutive field goals and extra points respectively. And finally, another kicker, Air Force punter Mark Simon, led the nation in that category.
Jim Brandenburg likes to call them the sixth man. Opponents call them intimidating. By whatever name, Wyoming's fans are the best, and they were never greater than during the NIT games at Laramie.
The total program for the University of Wyoming basketball includes our fans. And we just do not have spectators that come out and watch our games. They're active participants, and they're known as our sixth man. They're vocal, they're active, they add enthusiasm and energy to our program, and our players react and play off of the sixth man. And the sixth man is very, very important to our program. It's one of the keys to our success.
It was that sixth man that kept the Cowboy energy level at an ionospheric high. Each fed off the other, and the results were out of this world. First, it was a good Texas A&M bunch, tri-champs of the Southwest Conference. Before a crowd of 9,035, the Pokes won it 79-70. Impressed by that crowd, the NIT granted Wyoming yet another game. This time, Loyola Marymount from the West Coast would be the opponent. An even larger crowd of 11,658 turned out to see the Pokes win a racehorse game 99-90. By now, not only were the Cowboys receiving national recognition, but so was the sixth man. Little old Wyoming was leading the NIT in attendance after two rounds, and its reward was to host a quarterfinal game. At no other time in Cowboy basketball history was the interest as high. Clemson of the Big Bad Athletic Coast Conference was coming to 7,200 feet, and what an event it would be.
And I think it was a crucial game. This year was a game before the Final Four in New York. We played a very good Clemson team. And I think as far as talent goes, they were every bit as good as we were. And they were every bit as good a team with as good strength and good as players. But it came down to our crowd having a 15,048 sellout with more people than there were seats coming to watch us. I don't think we could have gotten beat on that night just because of the crowd.
It was the largest crowd ever to see a basketball game at Wyoming. A record 15,028 was delirious. The Cowboys might have been able to beat anyone that night. It happened to be Clemson, and what a game it was. The Tigers jumped out to a quick 5-point lead, but the Pokes came back to lead by as many as 11 in the first half. Twice in the second half, they led by as many as 12, but this one was much closer than that. The Tigers closed to within 3 with 25 seconds left. But fittingly, Wyoming's final points came on a reverse slam by Turk Boyd, following a Sean Dent steal. Victory belonged to the Cowboys, and their sixth man went crazy. It was up to the animated one, Electric Fennis, to apply the finishing touches. Dembo, the Cowboys, and the state of Wyoming were on top of the world. The Pokes and their sixth man were headed for the Big Apple. It is the hub of the world. Its excitement is unmatched. The Pokes had made it to New York, to Madison Square Garden, and the NIT semifinals. The opponent was Florida, a team that had finished the season with a flourish, a talented team from the Southeast Conference. The Pokes were an underdog, of course, a tag with which they had become familiar. Some of those lessons that they had learned back at Louisville became valuable in this one, like dealing with a talented team in a pressure situation, for instance. It was obvious from the outset that Florida was talent-rich, and the Gators showed it by running out to a 12-point lead. They did it primarily on the perimeter shooting of Joe Lawrence. Because of his shooting, the Pokes had to dispense with their patented zone defense in favor of a man-to-man. John Summers was assigned to Lawrence. He did not score another point, and by half, the Cowboys had cut the margin to 5. They trailed 37-32. In the final half, Wyoming came out smoking. The Pokes overwhelmed Florida, outscoring their opponent by 14 points. Dembo and Lechner were dominating, with 23 and 19 points respectively. It was a magical moment for the Pokes, but the evening was blemished when Turk Boyd sprained an ankle with just 40 seconds left in the game. That injury would seriously affect the championship game. The Cowboys were there. All of the work, all of the practice, all of the concentration had paid off. Wyoming had made it to the NIT final and a date with Ohio State in the Garden. A scriptwriter could not have created a season like this one. It was not the usual Cowboy team that took the floor against Ohio State. With his ankle rendering Boyd questionable, Wyoming would be starting a different lineup, something that had not happened since early in the season. Not only did the Pokes miss Boyd's production on the floor, but his status affected them psychologically. The Boyd situation and early foul trouble proved more than the proud Cowboys could overcome, and their bid for a national championship fell 10 points short to an outstanding Buckeye team. But back home, there was a collective standing ovation by a state full of proud and appreciative fans. An ovation for what had been, but more importantly, for what was to come. These young Cowboys had produced a season for all seasons in 1985-86 and matured into men in the process. What lies ahead for this Wyoming team is the stuff of which dreams are made.